Shimoga, how are you? Good morning. This is the second time I'm coming to the second version of KTES. License available?
Yeah.
I have to switch on or just switch on? It's on, I think. Yeah, so this is the second version of KTES, and it's a proud moment for me to be here again, back in my campus. Last year I came here and spoke how this entire hub can be developed as the next innovation hub, you know. So in last year's address I mentioned about why the next world level disruptive innovation can't be happened from Shimoga labs. And I'm proud to announce, and this year we have executed that vision, and yesterday many of you must have seen that we have entered into MOU with JNNC to execute world first air computing research program in JNNC lab. That's a great moment for all of us here. And with this program, we are going to put JNNC Shimoga in par with the international university, research universities like MIT. And many of you might be knowing the computing technology which we have right now, silicon-based, IC-based, microprocessor-based, they are not going to support the next 2 year, 3 year down the line computing requirement. So the world is looking for alternate computing technology. That's why we have also initiated world first air computing research program, which I think yesterday I briefed about that. But today's topic is different here. You know, many entrepreneurs have gathered here. I want to, last month I was attending a SOCHM conference where our PM Narendra Modi was there. He addressed the gathering of the industrialists and entrepreneurs in New Delhi. And there this topic came up, $5 trillion economy, because that's the last year he said that India has to become $5 trillion economy. And in most of the TV debates, you must be listening about whether it's possible or not. Somebody will say, slow down, is there, somebody is there. So a lot of problem will come up, a lot of counter question will come up. But if China can be such a big economy, if US can be such a big economy, then we are talking about 1/4 or 1/5 of size of those economy. It's quite possible with such a wonderful young generation of India can't be achieved $5 trillion. Now, startup roles in achieving $5 trillion Indian economy is very, very critical. You know, the reason, because the man and material based GDP, which we have seen so long, like you're creating a building, you're creating a factory, then now then typically they will say that you're adding to GDP. But still the innovation share and research share, knowledge related output share in our national GDP is still very less. So the tech entrepreneurs and tech startups, they will bring the new value in Indian GDP through their innovation and fundamental research. So that's what the topic is here. And I hope this will give you direction and which direction you can work so that your startups will also succeed. And you will also add to the goal of national goal of building $5 trillion economy. Because this is not the government duty only to build the economy. It's the duty of all its citizens, Indian citizens, you know, to build $5 trillion economy. How many of you agree, you know, I was talking about the knowledge economy. How many of you agree that the industrial economy to knowledge economy transformation will add our GDP? Similarly, the gig economy, you understand what is gig economy? How many of you understand what is gig economy? So many freelancers, you know, they are a part of gig economy. So gig economy also, if you see, so it's saying the knowledge economy will fetch more money, gig economy will fetch more money. How many of you will agree here? How many of you agree? How many know that knowledge economy is the future? How many will agree here? Any idea what is knowledge economy? So technology we are discussing, this is the part of knowledge economy, you know. And if you are building a building over there, you're building a factory over there, you know, some material, some construction, that will be the industrial economy, right? So I think both need to go together, industrial economy and knowledge economy, but it need to be largely driven by knowledge. Okay. So I see many counters how India can become a 5 trillion economy, you know. So definitely if we remain here only, we will not move from here to here, then definitely this question is very relevant. How will we become today to, we are sitting at 2.72 trillion. In 2-3 years, how will we become 5 trillion? So that question is very genuine. But if you listen the thought of this professor, this Nobel Prize winner professor, then you will believe that how knowledge economy can turn a lesser size economy to a bigger size economy. So his research has been recognized by Nobel Prize. So I'll just play his video.
It should be playing from slide only.
He's a co-recipient of the 2018 Nobel Memorial Prize in Economics for developing the endogenous growth theory, which argues that investments in human capital, innovation and knowledge are significant contributors to economic growth. Please welcome on stage Paul Romer.
I worked on the specifics of how does technology lead to economic growth. And I think it's very important with a term like growth that you have some idea of a metric. So GDP per capita is the established metric. And it's not perfect, but it clarifies our conversations if we just stay focused on a measure, because we start throwing around different measures, we just end up kind of getting confused. So in terms of GDP per capita, part of what I showed was is that ideas are incredibly powerful and incredibly encouraging because they can sustain growth even in a world where objects and resources are scarce. Over time, what emerged from that work was that ideas have this other benefit, which is that we start to see other people as allies, because if they discover something, we can take use benefit from their discovery. So we kind of are rivals over, like, you know, if there's a deposit of copper, more people means less copper per person. So that, in that sense, we're rivals. But if somebody discovers better way to use copper or an alternative to copper, we can all benefit from the discovery. So ideas mean that we can have sustained economic growth, and we can not just have more stuff, but be better people in the sense of connecting with and appreciating others, not seeing them as hostiles.
What the message this professor gave, the idea has capability to add the economy of a country. You know, the traditional economy were built on man and material and resources. The new age economy is built on knowledge. So knowledge has potential to grow the economy of a country. And we are the tech entrepreneurship. This technology is knowledge, nothing else, right? Of course, through knowledge only you utilize material and resources. But essentially, technology is knowledge, idea. So if you see this yesterday, keynote speaker was asking about the GDP of India, is also asking about the GDP of US. So you can see where we are in the global. We are here, 2.72. So visible, is visible from far, 2.72 or 73 trillion dollar is the Indian economy. Okay, now this we have to take to 5 trillion as per the PM goal. By 2025 we have to do 5 trillion economy. And then US is sitting here, 20.49. Yesterday you said 25 trillion. Maybe like this might be 6 month old data. So, and China, if you see, China is also second largest economy, sitting around 15 trillion. Okay, so now there are debates going on that if we have to grow for the 5 trillion, then we have to grow at the rate of 10%, right? 10%, someone say 9%. But what is the fact? We have slipped down from 7.2 to even 6.1, and between 6 and 6.5%. So the question comes, then how will it become 5 trillion? If this is the growth rate, then how comes the 5 trillion? So these are the concerns I listed here, you know, which you all must be seeing in all TV debates, you know, what are the concerns of Indian economy. But I'll find out the solution. I'm linking this Tech Entrepreneur Summit with the solution, right? So if you see in innovation index, we lag here. We are at 52 rank in India. It's 52 rank in global innovation index. So one thing is clear, if we want to build up the knowledge economy, we have to raise our innovation ranking, innovation, global innovation ranking. So how will it happen? It will be done by you entrepreneurs only, you know. You have to innovate, you have to come up with a bigger idea, you have to impact globally. So if you, you know, this is the chart, innovation versus GDP per capita. Yesterday, Naga was also asking the question, what is the Indian GDP per capita? If you see here, we have plotted this curve. Huh? This GDP per capita, for India it is coming here, you know, and the highest per capita income, you know, of course the developed economies and European countries, they have the highest income per capita. And when you map here, the innovation index, so India mapping currently is here. So if India has to go to 5 trillion level, then they have to increase their innovation ranking. And they have to also increase their GDP per capita. GDP per capita is nothing but in terms of the income, raising the income of the people of India. That will also come through innovation only. Okay, so this is where we are presently. Okay, so what are the concluding observations from this? This is the global, say the whole world economy is mapped here, if you see. Whole world economy is mapped in this graph. So what is the conclusion of this mapping? If you see US we have seen 20-25 trillion economy, 50% comes from growth in innovation, innovative startups, tech startups, patents, new patents are filed. They are contributing the 50% of the GDP, you know. And we are, in India, if you see, we are not even 5-10%, you know. We are still struggling to go over there. So, contribution of innovation, technology research in Indian GDP is very, very less. Nobody is thinking on that direction. Everybody is thinking that, yeah, the farmers should do more farming. That's okay, that we have to improve. You know, if the growth has been slowed down in farming sector, growth has been slowed down in construction sector, I'm not denying that this need to be improved. But what I'm saying, why only we remain debating and taking a stress of only 2 or 3 sectors? Those are the core sectors of Indian economy. That is okay. But another remedy is increase your innovation throughput. You know, we increase your innovation output through innovative research and launching those research products in market. That's what the entrepreneurs are discussing here. How to do innovation and how to launch a market and how to convert those ideas into revenue earning streams so that your GDP gets increased. So intangible assets like brand, value, IP also contribute in GDP growth. So you don't have to only build a solution, you have to also build a brand for you. So solution part will fetch the revenue from sales and brand part will fetch the brand equity to you. You know? So brand will help in increasing your global presence. Also, in case you want to exit your business, your not only your product innovation will fetch, but your brand value will also fetch. You know, so many big brands are getting sold and they are bought not only for the product they are producing, but they are bought also for the brand and the brand equity they have. They are the brand having image in their mind of customer. They are bought the billion and billions of dollars deal, you know, because they have the big, huge brand name. Okay, so brand, the IP, intellectual property, right? These all are part of intangible assets. So right now the Indian GDP not having accounted based on intangible assets. So future intangible assets like your codes, algorithms, they will have certain monetary value which will add to the Indian GDP. So in US, so if you see in US, two data of US I'm saying, 50% is the role of innovation in GDP. Similarly, around 9%, 8.8% is the contribution of intangible assets like brand. or intellectual property in the GDP. And we are lagging very behind in this. If you see country like Sweden, Sweden is plotted here, I think, in the top. So if you see, they have 10.4% share of the intangible assets like brands. Which is the biggest Swedish company, can you remember? I think ABB comes under mine, Swedish. Siemens is from where? Germany. ABB is from Sweden, right? Everybody knows that ABB. How big is the brand? Very big brand, right? So such kind of brands we have to, not only one and two or three brands, we have to target thousands and lakhs of brands coming out from towns like Shimoga, Bangalore, Mysuru, everywhere of India, you know? So such a big brand you have to build if you really want to build 5 trillion economy. So India has potential to improve its innovation ranking, its GDP per capita ranking, you know. So what is the target for? What should be our target? So if these are some of the assumptions which you remain seeing, if economy grows at 9%, then which year we will hit 5 trillion mark? If economy grows at 8%, which year will hit the target mark? And if 7%, which year? So these are some assumptions. But my point here is very clear. Even if we remain growing at moderate 7% in next 2-3 years, which I think overall many people will agree, but then also there is a possibility that we will hit 5 trillion mark. There are two areas which we have to work. I also earlier highlighted, adding higher value through innovation. So target 25% of GDP growth. Today, if 7% is the growth of GDP, then 7%, 25% of that 7% should come through innovation and higher exports by leveraging or by building your global brands. So the day you have launched your startup, you have to think on your branding. Your branding will not only add value to you, and build an asset for you, intangible asset for you, but it also fetches export revenue for you. It will help you in getting the export revenue for you. Okay. So similarly, expanding the contribution of intangible assets by robust global branding and IP creation to 8 to 10% of GDP through those intangible assets. Like in US, you are seeing, we are getting 8.9 or 8% of GDP through intangible assets. In Sweden, they are getting 10.5%. So why we can't also target similar range of GDP coming through intangible assets like IP, intellectual property, and brands. Even codes, your codes are intellectual property. So we only see that products are getting sold or not. The codes you have written, that is intellectual property. That has also market value, right? You know, tomorrow you must sell that code to someone else, then you are trying to exit your company. So you have to leverage your codes also, your algorithm also, your models also, your data also, everything. You have to make asset. You may not call it tangible asset, but it becomes a tangible asset, which has role in making Indian GDP higher. So if we follow these two strategy, so what will happen? India is presently here. We will, in next 5 years, 4 to 5 years, we can push the ranking of India on global innovation index here. So if we go here, so we have to rise on the innovation index through more patents, through more IP creation, and we have to also rise our GDP per capita. So we will reach here, and this is the 5 trillion target we are talking about. So I think with this two dedicated focus approach, we can take India to 5 trillion, and role of startups are very, very important in that, because they will be creating the IP, they will be creating the innovation, they should also create the brand for them. Okay. Now coming to the basic question. Well, I said it should be disruptive technology. I'm not only calling it innovation. It should be bringing disruption. The way the things are working today, it should disrupt that. So what is the disruptive technology? And how an innovation and tech startups can create the value? What is disruptive tech startup? What is the strategy of moving from competition to disruption? So you just want to compete. If you just want to compete, then how will add the extra GDP? You are just taking market share of existing player to your company. Then you are not disrupting it. They're just replacing one company. So what's happened? Zomato is getting replaced by Swiggy. That's all happening. But that we can't call a disruption. Disruption is a new way of doing things, which is never thought of. You are going here from your home, you will find n number of inefficiency in between where you are wasting your time. Can we detect those inefficiencies and can we launch a technology innovation or disruptive startup over there to increase your productivity, to increase your time utilization? So everywhere you see around world, everywhere the opportunities are there. So when you disrupt existing agile environment, then you will start adding value to the economy. By mere competing in the market, you won't be adding much value. You will be adding value to your pocket, but you won't be adding value to the economy because you are just replacing other income to buy your income. But you are not creating new income, right? You are taking market share of someone else's established player, but you are not creating a new market. So when I say disruptive startup, you create your own niche, you create your own market, which only you are playing in that. And which is new. Nobody explored further. Like Naga was telling about yesterday, one NLP company founded in Chennai, in IIT Chennai, Madras. That's a new world. Nobody earlier explored that. So they created a new market. There is no competition in that. He said that no competition virtually, because that particular software, NLP software, is converting more than 600 languages. You know, you speak any language, they will identify that. Okay, so what you are speaking. So those kind of startups are disruptive startups. You can call it innovative also, but at the same time they are disruptive also. So innovative can be in the existing competition field also. You do some innovation and take the market share of existing player. That you can call innovative startup. But when you mix disruption with innovation, then it becomes disruptive startup. You are changing the how the paradigm, how a particular transaction is done, how a particular business is done. So that is the difference. So I think innovation is good, but you have to see whether you are bringing disruption or not. So that's what I say, moving from competition to disruption, if you really add long impact value to Indian GDP. And how the disruption creates value, that still we can debate, and how much Indian tech startups need to create value for 5 trillion economy. So I said that in percentage I replied that how much we need to increase our ranking in innovation index and how much we have need to increase our GDP per capita, right? So we will see further, I want to see here global perspective. I'll come to Indian perspective later on. First, try to understand global perspective. Who are the tech innovators? Who are the leading tech disruptors? So if you see this CV Insight ranking, the highest value startups in the world. So these are some startups names are given, but the valuations are also given here. If you see $75 billion is the first, the artificial intelligence company. Then the second is also like Ola Cab, Uber Cab, this Didi. It's a Chinese company, $56 billion. And then, EduTech, FinTech, Airbnb, we all know, SpaceX, Elon Musk's startup, the satellite launching company. And in India, Paytm is also there. Fortunately, one company from India is global 10 highest. But now, yesterday we were debating whether Paytm can be called as a startup or not. That's of course, but matter of debate, but at least Paytm name is there in the global ranking, right? So what I'm saying, if you see these, the global startup economy is worth nearly $3 trillion, which is around 3.5% of the global GDP, which is around $85 trillion. The global GDP is $85 trillion. So these are the valued startups. So you have to evaluate your startup also, where you're standing, okay? So that is the valuation ranking, and this is the disruption ranking. This is another perspective I am bringing. Of course, the disruptor can be most valuable. There is a correlation between the disruption ranking and valuable ranking. More disruptive you become, the more valuable you become. Because I said, the valuation will not increase by mere competition. You have to disrupt, you have to change the paradigm.
through your innovative model. So these are the, again, you see the same companies ranked previously here in terms of valuation is also getting ranked in terms of disruption. You know, so it's still Chinese companies ranked second number by CNBC in global 50 disrupted company list. So first is here Indigo AG, which is farming company. AGTech, you can say AGTech. Second is the DD, the Beijing-based company, is the public transportation taxi services like Ola, Uber. Then WeWork. I don't know how many of you use the WeWork spaces. Everywhere in Bangalore, you must be this co-working space. You know, so the moment you are opening your startup, you look for a shared offices. So WeWork provide that. Okay, so they have also emerged in the top PIP disruptions. The Grab is a Singapore-based company, and Rent the Runway is a New York-based company. So
number five, Rent the Runway, continuing to transform the way women shop, dress, and now decorate their homes. The five-time disruptor now is worth $1 billion with 11 million members. Number four, Grab. The Southeast Asian giant is expanding far beyond ride sharing, now a platform for everything related to transportation, with partnerships with the likes of Microsoft, expanding its reach into financial services and insurance. Number three, the We Company. It rebranded from WeWork earlier this year as the co-working company pushes into apartments, hotels, and retail. Recently valued at $47 billion, the company took its first step to file to go public.
WeWork is always ready for an IPO. We will choose the right time to do it when it's correct for the mission of the company.
Number two, Didi Xuxing. Far more than just the Uber of China, Didi offers a dozen transportation options to 550 million users around the world, while its big data arm called Didi Brain tackles traffic and logistics. And number one, Indigo Ag, a $3.5 billion agricultural technology startup that mixes microbiology with artificial intelligence to improve yield, sustainability, and profits for growers of commodity crops like cotton and corn. Last year, it introduced a digital platform connecting growers and buyers, tracking indigo crops from seed to table.
Well, agriculture is a $3 trillion plus global industry, and we've seen a growing number of venture capitalists investing in companies that are applying digital technologies like artificial intelligence and machine learning to the global food system. This year's number one disruptor has become a leader in the ag tech revolution.
So, from a global perspective, if you see which are the tech sector have performed well, are performing well so far, you know. This is like a perspective so that if you're founding the company, then you know which one, which sector is growing, which is doing a little bit moderate performance. So of course, if you see from the funding perspective, they have measured the growth here from funding potential and funding perspective. And they have also measured growth, the valuation or exit growth. So if you see the maximum growth is coming in the robotics startups and industry 4.0 startups like advanced manufacturing, AI, big data analytics, you know, the AG, agriculture tech, you have seen the topmost Indigo AG, the topmost disruptor, ranked the first, that was also a AG tech company, right? So AG tech is also doing good, then blockchain is also doing good. Okay, and then if you see the maturity phase, then fintech, which was leading earlier, now it is like more of a stable segment. So fintech is ranked here as mature segment. Cybersecurity, clean tech, life sciences, and the gaming this year, and edutech this year have gone down in the declining phase. If you see the interest of the investor, if you see the valuations, they have gone down, this sector has gone down. So why we are presenting this perspective? When you are planning your startup, you should align with some type of global perspective also, you know. Apart from your disruptive idea, you need to also keep these things in mind. Which sector is growing, which sector is maturing, you know. So So this is another performance index of global tech ventures. So I said the advanced manufacturing robotics is the topmost growing sector. You will see the early stage deal have grown in 5 years by 107.9%. Exits have also grown up, 143% growth has seen. And it's a small volume right now, only 1.8% of the startups are in that area. But the creation growth, if you see, it is 6.6%. Blockchain is the highest in that way. It is the creation growth is 23.9%. And the early stage deals are 101.5%. AG Tech and New Food, that has gone also a big way. Big data analytics have grown also big way, but that exit growth has been highest in big data analytics, but the startup creation growth is not that much high in big data analytics. And if you see, this is another perspective here, percentage of new startups created by 2 years period. So in recent year, if you see, the AI and big data analytics has got the highest creation. Of course, you will see that there is a contradiction, because this is the 5-year-old period and this is 2 year period. So of late it has picked up, right? This segment. The growing segment we discussed, then the declining segment, ad tech, gaming, digital media, and edutech and ad tech. You understand the difference? Ad tech is advertisement related, digital advertisement, you know. With advertisement you see in portals and like YouTube's, those belong to ad tech segment. And the edutech is all education related startups, education related learning, e-learning, software, e-learning, startups, all falls under. Digital media is all like content servicing provider, content media providers, right? So you've seen how they have grown, like till 15, 16 they were growing, now they are in declining path. So this will say, this will guide you where is the growth, right? And Indian tech startup, you see, that was the global outlook. This is the Indian outlook. In India, you will find that here also fintech has come under the matured level. So fintech has come under matured level, and health tech, enterprise, IT, retail, these all now have become matured level, but investments have grown. The investments are highest in these areas. Still in India, people are investing in fintech. In global world, people are not so much excited about new investment in fintech, but Indian world, Indian space, startup space, still investors are excited about fintech startups. So fintech is still growing in India. But you have the emerging sectors here also. EduTech, SCM, supply chain management, mobility, travel and hospitality. And the nascent emerging segment is industrial manufacturing, gaming. So gaming is sunset industry in global markets, but here it's still, here also it is shown very low in axes. So media and entertainment, this is how the Indian startups landscape looks like. Another perspective, so these are some of the featured startups in supply chain and logistics, edutech, mobility, the Indian startups I am talking about. These are some of the huge cases their startups are solving. You know, you are able to see ours, there are so many huge cases and different for different sectors. Like in edutech, you have test preparation. These are the popular huge cases to be solved, or problem statement to be solved by building your tech startup. Similarly, tutor discovery, okay. Then tech-enabled classroom. So many categories are there. Mobility, the whole battery ecosystem, the circular economy of battery, that is coming into picture. One of our JNNC alumni, last year he left Cisco job in Bangalore and he started this battery circular economy. based startup. This is a startup name is Plugo. You can connect him with LinkedIn, right? He's based out of Bangalore and he's operating from NASCOM. Last year we went there in NASCOM. Okay, NASCOM 10,000 startup center is there in Hoswell Road, I think, in Bangalore. So from there he's starting. So the whole battery tech is also emerging in mobility, you know, because the vehicles are also moving towards the battery. So you need some kind of charging system. You can't install charging everything. So what's happening? That circular economy, like you take a charged battery and you exchange with your exhausted battery, and some company will provide that services where you can, on petrol pump, you can just replace that battery, you know, if your battery is vacuum. But similarly, for mobile also, these kind of exchange circular economy is coming. So battery tech is also coming in a big way. It doesn't mean that you are inventing a battery technology. It is just like how you circulate the battery among your customers. That is the point of idea here, you know, for selling in market, right? So many startups are listed here. AgriTech, I have also discussed from the global perspective. So there are some Indian startups listed here. What are the popular use cases in AgriTech which are addressed by startups? You know, these are some are listed here. And industrial and manufacturing is the old segment. Gaming, though it globally is going down, but in Indian space is still showing some growth. Media and entertainment. Okay, so this is just like giving a rough idea. What all under the broad industrial segment of tech startup, what are the micro segments which are emerging, you know? So this is another perspective, IoT, AI, ML, machine learning and artificial intelligence, big data, analytics, blockchain, AR, VR, drones, and others. These are some of the growing segments, and this will show a pie chart, you know, which technology owns how much percentage of a startup. So 1600 plus deep tech startups have been plotted into this, right? This graph. So if you see the number of startups who have the area where the highest startups are founded is the AI, Internet of Things, Big Data Analytics, Blockchain, AR, VR, this augmented reality and virtual reality. But if you see this, like when I'm talking about innovation, why innovation is important for economic growth, only 50%, so whatever products the startups are launching in India, only 50% are bringing innovative products. Rest are just copy, like Naga was also telling, you know, we are copying, very good in copying, you know, okay, somebody did this, so we should also do that. So remaining, you know, some improved version or something like, so 50% they are saying, this is the RBI data, but as per my estimate, even it may be actually less than 50%, you know. So rest of the 50% only doing copy paste. So we have to increase this. If we have to grow to 5 trillion economy, we have to increase this share, you know. So this is another prediction by NASCOM. India has potential to create more than 100 unicorns by 2025. So 100 unicorns means plus $1 billion valuation. So how we were in this year? We have 24 unicorn companies, and in next 5 years we are targeting more than 100. And so valuation will also go up. So the startup, this 100 top 100 startup valuation will grow 100 plus billion to around 400 billion or 390 billion, you will say, in next 5 years. This is the job growth projected in indirect jobs. So these are some of the projections. Okay. So which are the segment of a startup which fetch highest return to entrepreneurs as well as investors? So this will provide that perspective, which all segment of startup fetch higher return to the investor as well as entrepreneur. Of course, if you are investing your time and money, you'd like to have good return. So
These are the segments: consumer technology, enterprise technology, banking, fintech, manufacturing, healthcare, okay, logistic, energy, consumers. This will give you just an idea. And this may change. Next year, some of the other sector will fetch higher amount of return. But this nutshell, this is what is the present trend. So I was telling in last month, this was the headline in Economic Times and Hindu, the financial newspaper. Angel investors earn 16-fold return by selling logistic startup LogiNext. In fact, Sanjay Mehta was supposed to come here also. He is the investor of in this company. This LogiNext is a transportation automation startup, LogiNext. So he got exit from that company. Whatever share he had, he got exit, and it fetched him 16 times higher return in just few years timeline. I think he remained invested for around 4 years or 5 years timeline. He is the investor, 130 companies includes Oyo Rooms, okay, and 3 crore he funded in LogiNext, and then he got the 16-fold result. So it was the headline in newspapers last month. If you see the Swiggy exit, the investors of Swiggy, they also got exit. So this is just it will just say that how big exits are fetching return. If you see return here, how some of the investors got return. Okay, so like if you say if you know they invested 42 crores and they exit from Swiggy, they got 439 crores. So how much value it created to economy and to investors and to entrepreneurs? So similarly, SL, they said invested 14.66 crore in Swiggy, and when they withdrawn their share, they sold it, they got 179 crore. So this is just a figure, you know, some of the good companies are giving higher return. So in Swiggy, the investors got 10x return, more than 10 times return. So there they got 16 times higher returns. So when you are conceptualizing your startups, you have to also see how it fetches higher return to you and to your investor, because that attracts the investors. So how artificial intelligence is going to create value? This is another projection. Okay, so this is the global projection, this side, left side, and this is the Indian projection. So it is going to definitely add into Indian GDP. Now, without AI, Indian value addition will be this. If you add AI technology, the value addition will be this. So this is one projection, right? So AI has potential to add around 1 trillion to Indian economy by 2035. Thus, by improving the productivity, by pursuing the new sectors, new opportunity. So this is the global projection, globally. So globally it is going to add 15 trillion. In India it is 15 trillion by 2030. And India in previous slide you have seen, it is projected to add GDP of 1 trillion by 2035. So this is another projection, 60% of Indian GDP to come from AI and digital services by 2021. So by these all projections, you will be able to see what is the importance of technology in Indian GDP. So if our government say we have to become $5 trillion economy, at the same time, we can't neglect our tech startup ecosystem. We have to boost, or we have to rehance or relaunch our entire ecosystem of tech startups to match with this projected growth rate, right? So what are the key takeaway points here? With present pace of growth and business as usual, India is likely to have shortfall of a cumulative economic value add of around 2 trillion during next 5 years. So 5 trillion is projected. So
So 5 trillion is like that year, 2025, but before that also you will remain growing. So if you say it will be the present growth rate of 6.1 to 6.5, if you see in the next 5 years, we will have a shortfall of 2 trillion US dollars to hit the target of 5 trillion by 2025. So to make up this 2 trillion shortfalls, we have to push our effort in AI and innovative technology and startups. So, but innovations and disruptive technology like AI, blockchain, fifth generation telecom services, 5G, IoT, AR, VR, we have power to augment existing Indian firms and organization for compensating at least 1 trillion worth economic value through higher efficiency, productivity, business expansion, value add, exports, and brand equity gain. So I'm saying, if you have, this is our my calculation, 5-year research calculation, that 5-year cumulative, 2 trillion is the shortfall. So only debate we should have, how to match this 2 trillion shortfall. A 5-year cumulative I'm talking about, I'm not talking about 1 year. So if I divide 2 trillion in 5-year duration, how much it will come? How much it will come roughly every year we have to target. So that is like 0.4, 0.5. Every year we have to compensate. So for that I'm saying the bigger firms like public sectors and private bigger company, they have to adopt technology. They have to improve their efficiency and productivity. So 1 trillion, they have to compensate. This is my calculation, my appeal to them, that you deploy more productive technology. Like all these big LIC, banks, they need to improve their productivity. State Bank of India, let them adopt AI to improve their productivity and efficiency and compensate that one at least 50% of this shortfall by increasing the productivity through artificial intelligence, blockchain, and other digital technology, innovative technology, and innovative processes. So 1 trillion they will compensate, and a startup has to add another 1 trillion compensation. Whatever startups are doing right now, they have to grow from there. Next 5 years, they have to compensate 1 trillion worth economic value they have to add. Then, if this is done, then India will become 5 trillion by 2025. So I think I'm doing justice here. I'm not giving very hard target to startups. I say existing enterprises should also push up their effort and let them compensate 1 trillion. And the startups world, let us focus on another 1 trillion, another 50% of shortfall. And step up your innovation, step up of your product capability, step up your export of your brand to at least add 1 trillion economic both economic value in Indian economy by 2025. So at least this can be done, and this larger enterprise can contribute to another trillion, that India is going to reach 5 trillion by 2025. Thus, the role of innovation-driven disruptive technology startups of India, the potential to make 5 trillion economy by 2025. I am very optimistic about that. So that's what I brought this topic, so that you all get motivated, you all align with the national goal of taking India a 5 trillion economy. So your role is making 1 trillion value add to the Indian economy. So that is the key message. I'm leaving the forum here, and I'll remain your expecting your questions, whatever questions. If you have time, you can take right now, or we can take offline also. My mail ID is there. I'm also here. Thank you.